The Reproduction of Daily Life, by Freddie Perlman. Part 2, Alienation of Living Activity. In capitalist society, creative activity takes the form of commodity production, namely production of marketable goods, and the results of human activity take the form of commodities. Marketability or sellability is the universal characteristic of all practical activity and all products. The products of human activity which are necessary for survival have the form of saleable goods. They are only available in exchange for money, and money is only available in exchange for commodities. If a large number of men accept the legitimacy of these conventions, if they accept the convention that commodities are a prerequisite for money, and that money is a prerequisite for survival, then they find themselves locked into a vicious circle. Since they have no commodities, their only exit from this circle is to regard themselves, or parts of themselves, as commodities. And this is, in fact, the peculiar solution, which men impose on themselves in the face of specific material and historical conditions. They do not exchange their bodies or parts of their bodies for money. They exchange the creative content of their lives, their practical daily activity, for money. As soon as men accept money as an equivalent for life, the sale of living activity becomes a condition for their physical and social survival. Life is exchanged for survival. Creation and production come to mean sold activity. A man's activity is productive, useful to society, only when it is sold activity, and the man himself is a productive member of society only if the activities of his daily life are sold activities. As soon as people accept the terms of this exchange, daily activity takes the form of universal prostitution. The sold creative power, or sold daily activity, takes the form of labor. Labor is a historically specific form of human activity. Labor is abstract activity which has only one property. It is marketable. It can be sold for a given quantity of money. Labor is indifferent activity, indifferent to the particular task performed and indifferent to the particular subject to which the task is directed. Digging, printing and carving are different activities, but all three are labor in capitalist society. Labor is simply earning money. Living activity which takes the form of labor is a means to earn money. Life becomes a means of survival. This ironic reversal is not the dramatic climax of an imaginative novel. It is a fact of daily life in capitalist society. Survival, namely self-preservation and reproduction, is not the means to creative practical activity, but precisely the other way around. Creative activity in the form of labor, namely sold activity, is a painful necessity for survival. Labor is the means to self-preservation and reproduction. The sale of living activity brings about another reversal. Through sale, the labor of an individual becomes the property of another. It is appropriated by another. It comes under the control of another. In other words, a person's activity becomes the activity of another, the activity of its owner. It becomes alien to the person who performs it. Thus one's life, the accomplishments of an individual in the world, the difference which his life makes in the life of humanity, are not only transformed into labor, a painful condition for survival, they are transformed into alien activity, activity performed by the buyer of that labor. In capitalist society, the architects, the engineers, the laborers, are not builders. The man who buys their labor is the builder. Their projects, calculations and motions are alien to them. Their living activity, their accomplishments, are his. Academic sociologists, who take the sale of labor for granted, understand this alienation of labor as a feeling. The worker's activity appears alien to the worker. It seems to be controlled by another. However, any worker can explain to the academic sociologists that the alienation is neither a feeling nor an idea in the worker's head, but a real fact about the worker's daily life. The sold activity is in fact alien to the worker. His labor is in fact controlled by its buyer. In exchange for his sold activity, the worker gets money, the conventionally accepted means of survival in capitalist society. With this money he can buy commodities, things, but he cannot buy back his activity. This reveals a peculiar gap in money as the universal equivalent. A person can sell commodities for money, and he can buy the same commodities with money. He can sell his living activity for money, but he cannot buy his living activity for money. The things the worker buys with his wages are first of all consumer goods which enable him to survive, to reproduce his labor power so as to be able to continue selling it, and they are spectacles, objects for passive admiration. He He consumes and admires the products of human activity passively. He does not exist in the world as an active agent who transforms it, but as a helpless, impotent spectator. He may call this state of powerless admiration happiness, and since labor is painful, he may desire to be happy, namely inactive, all his life, a condition similar to being born dead. The commodities, the spectacles, consume him. He uses up living energy in passive admiration. He is consumed by things. In this sense, the more he has, the less he is. An individual can surmount this death in life through marginal creative activity, but the population cannot, except by abolishing the capitalist form of practical activity, by abolishing wage labor and thus de-alienating creative activity.